All right. Good morning. Good morning. Happy Monday.
Good morning. Happy Monday. Isn't it a great Monday?
You know what? It's another sunny day. I can't stand it. I can't stand all this sun. Make it stop. No.
You know
Actually,
what? We do need some rain though, because hold on, let me check
yes.
my phone so I see. We do need some rain because the grass is starting to get dry and we do need some rain.
I agree. I agree. The little birdies are out there. So we actually have been filling our bird bath. And we've been watching the birds playing in it. Like they need it, absolutely. And the squirrels.
So
So it's
which birdies do you have in your garden?
we have a family of cardinals that are always in our yard. And you know what I love watching about cardinals? They're monogamous creatures. They mate for life. And so they really take care of each other.
Yeah,
And
they
we've
do.
seen them have their babies. I'm assuming they're the same family, but maybe they're not. But I like to think they are. And when they have their babies, it's the father that feeds them. It's really spectacular to watch.
And you see the woman always, the female always protects the male.
They're always together, eh? Looking out for each other.
No, it's only the female apparently that looks
Is
after
that
the
right?
male. Yeah,
I
because the
didn't know
male
that.
is more beautiful, right? They're more
Yeah,
obvious.
they
And
are.
so they can't hide. So the female always goes first, checks it out, and then the male flies in.
The male flies in. Okay, I've watched them, but I didn't get that. I'm going to look a little closer. And we
So
have them, and they've
that's
got, of
great.
course, what's that? Sorry?
You have what other ones? Sorry.
Chickadees and cowbirds, those really nice dark gray and light gray cowbirds. They've got a fun little song. And there was some cedar waxwings in our area the other day.
Now you're getting
Yeah,
PhD level.
yeah. As they fly through spring and fall, we get a nice little melange.
Wow. No, we only have, of course, sparrows, they're everywhere, but cardinal couple and robin.
Oh, and robins, yeah. We get a lot of those. I love how they sing in the morning. First thing in the morning, before the sun actually breaks the horizon, they start, and
Really?
then yeah, they'll start doing their little song, and they sing and sing for like an hour, and at night too, as the sun sets, that is their time. And I'd love to know what they're saying. Wouldn't it be fun to get into the mind of an animal,
Yeah.
right?
Well, it's funny because I try to chirp like the cardinal
Yeah.
whenever Kevin and I are walking and I'm trying to chirp like them. He's like, stop it. You're swearing at them. You're flying. They're flying
Yeah.
away from you. I'm so done with their chirping.
You're swearing at them. It's true. When you don't know what you're saying, be careful. Careful what you're saying.
But the interesting thing is that is nature, right? The females are always taking care of the males with a loving way, and the males go out there and get the food. So it's a very pragmatic system. And how we as humans mess that up, don't ask.
They sure did. Yeah, the hunters and gatherers. And yeah, because I think as women, we decided at some point that we're going to do it all. Right. And so, what came with that? What did that cost us? Holy crap, that cost us a lot because we decided we're going to go out and get the career, but we never really let go of taking care of the family. So, we continued to be there for the kids and run around for home and school days or whatever the case might be. Yeah. It ended up costing us a lot. And so this group, actually, when we're in our 50s and early 60s, whatever, we're often depleted because we've given it all away and we've run around like crazy, crazy nuts for how many decades,
Yeah, no,
right?
seriously. Cynthia Hum says, good morning, ladies.
Good
Good
morning,
morning,
Cynthia.
Cynthia. And this is the thing, I think we were talking about it yesterday, you and I, and I really want to dive into when do we stop?
When do we stop? Yeah,
Oh, it
yeah.
wasn't you I was talking to, it was another. I have a friend that I'm collaborating with, and she's come back around. She's been programmed so badly in the personal development industry. It took her 2 years by leaving that environment of noise to actually get to her truth. 2 years, right?
Right. I
And so
believe it.
yesterday, yeah, so yesterday she's we were talking, and just we're going into an initiative right now that's quite big. And she's like, and we were just talking. And we used to laugh because she's like the helium balloon, right? And I call her the helium balloon because she needed to always float in this la la land of fantasy dream. And even though she's a powerful coach, I used to laugh because I'm like, okay, you and I are together are like, I'm like the brick, like that big stone thing on the dock, that's holding up, that's just on the ground. And she's this helium balloon, and the only thing that connects us is that string.
Is the string. Right? Cut the string and whoop.
Yeah, any time 2 years ago when she was outside of her personal truth, like when she lost herself, even though she was highly successful, but she lost herself. And I used to always laugh because every time I brought something real up, like truth about what's going on, she would glaze over. She couldn't deal with reality, right?
No kidding.
And so I used to always say, thank goodness I'm here with her, because, like, you know, she's a helium balloon. She has to live in that false world, right, to survive. But then at the same time, she lifted my reality up a little bit so that I could go into her space. So that's what the beautiful union between me and her. We have a very special bond, even though we're totally different. But now 2.5 years later, she's come back and she's like, and she's so grounded. We talk about everything that's real out there. Like,
oh, wow.
Her eyes are wide open now. And I was saying to her yesterday, it's funny because I thought I was talking to you, but and it's like, how many of us just lose sense of what we want? And so I said, we need to start, and she's in marketing now. And I said, we need to start a campaign out there. Like, a campaign like this hashtag, stop fucking going. Stop. Hashtag just fucking stop.
Wow. Now there's a concept for us women. Do we know how to? No. Until our bodies tell us to. So I'll share my little story. On Friday, my back started kind of twinging. It was like in my back, in my hip. And I've never had sciatica problems, even through 2 pregnancies where I was huge. Don't know what it is. But when I was trying to describe the pain, my husband's had it. Other people I know have had it. And they were saying, yeah, I think that's sciatica. So the pain is absolutely excruciating. It actually sends, like, I was seeing stars for the first time. I was going black when the pain would hit, but then it would ease and then I'd be okay. And then it would, if I twisted wrong or sat wrong, it would hit. Yeah, really crazy thing. So that was Friday, but Saturday I decided to push through it because, I am woman, hear me roar, right? I mean, do us women, do we take a break ever? Do we fucking stop? No, we don't. We carry on. We push through. We got things to do, people to say, to see, places to go, right?
People to save.
Yeah. Right? Yeah, because, oh, God forbid we should take a day off and spend it in bed or something. So Saturday, what did I do Saturday? I absolutely pushed through for 8 solid hours from 9 in the morning till 5 at night. My husband and I decided to paint the cedar paneling in our family room. And it's beautiful panel. It's solid wood. And we've resisted for years and years and years and years because the idea of painting the wood was like, no, I can't do it. But it's dark in the family room. And we just knew we're always thinking of resale also. Which in itself is actually kind of not a good way to live, because I'm always kind of living temporary, thinking we're going to sell. Anyway, this has been going on for years. We still haven't sold. But anyway, we decided, bite the bullet, let's paint the freaking paneling. In order to do that, we had to pull up a lot of the wall-to-wall carpeting, because we knew we'd have to replace the carpeting too. So I was on my knees, I was stretching, I was pulling, I was twisting, got the carpet up, and of course wall to wall, that involves all those little strips of wood filled with nails, so then you're hurting yourself. And then there's a bunch of staples, got to get them up, and then sand the walls, wash the walls, and then primer the walls. And we got a lot of that done. We got like three quarters of it kind of done, and exhausted by the end of the day. Well, you can imagine my back, or my sciatica, or whatever the hell it is. By Saturday night, I was in a lot of pain. And I had to take a Tylenol or an ibuprofen or something for the first time. Yesterday, I was in a lot of pain. So when you and I spoke yesterday morning, of course it came up, well, what's the body telling me? Is the body, and I know this, and I've talked to people about it, that the body is the hardware and the mind is the software. So what's going on in the mind will control what's going on in the body. And I've played with that over the years. I've been able to get rid of gallstones naturally. And so this time I was like, hey, what's the body telling me? It's telling me to stop. But I don't want to stop. But my subconscious mind is saying stop. And so my body's saying, well, if you're not going to freaking listen to your body, I'm gonna make you stop. So this morning I looked up this lovely little book, Louise Hay, Heal Your Body, this little gem of a book. If you don't know it, Louise Hay spent 30 years of research into this little gem, and nobody wanted to publish it at the time because it was too woo-woo when she first came out with it. And so she actually photocopied it in the church basement, one of those old copy machines, and went around distributing it to like door to door. And by word of mouth alone, it became like still in print to this day. Crazy. Yeah, it started, the first printing was in 1976. Anyway, sciatica. So what is the meaning of it? The metaphysical manifestation of the mind is you're being hypocritical. That's interesting. Is it hypocritical or is it hypocritical?
You hate that word so much.
Yeah, I couldn't say it.
Yeah. No, you know what? And this wow. is classic how we get to know ourselves, what's really going on, because the truth is beautiful, right?
Yes.
The truth is beautiful. The hypocrisy is not, right? But you can't even, you hate that word so much.
Yeah.
You can't even say it properly.
I can't even say it properly. Wow. Wow, that's interesting. And it's interesting to break it up into two parts, you know, that you're being hypocritical or you're being hypocritical. And it's also fear of money and of the future. And that definitely comes into play, not so much of the money part, but of the future part, because hitting 60, it changes the mindset into really start looking at how, first of all, how fast life went. It's insane how quick it goes. And so you're kind of staring into the mirror at your finiteness, that you know that you're on the other side of the runway. You know, how many more years do you have? You know, like all of this can start really playing mind games with you. And so I always have to kind of self-correct myself and just say, okay, just, you know, just be at least in the moment, because in the moment things are good. But, you know, that those little fear bubbles, and what am I going to be doing? I can't see myself doing nothing, because I'm just not a nothing kind of gal. So what am I doing? And where am I living? We keep talking about moving, but where the hell are we going? So there's all these like unknowns, and some are exciting, but some are like, oh my God. Anyway, so then she gives you the affirmation of what to say to yourself to try and bring yourself back into center. And so her affirmation is, I move into my greater good. My good is everywhere, and I am secure and safe. So it's a lovely gem, and you know, and it works. I used one of her affirmations for sure when I was going through the gallbladder, my gallstones. That was a huge thing, and sure enough, like, you know, the gallstone thing was all about bitterness, you know, resentment, and you know, you've got to really look at yourself, and you've got to get real, and you've got to get out of your own hypocrisy. You've got to get, you know, absolutely real and honest with yourself to dig out what's really going on, because the front of the brain just wants to be all happy and Pollyanna, you know, but the back of the brain, you know, that's where the real shit lies, right? What did you call it?
You know, Polly is not my best friend.
Mm-hmm.
But you know what? It's really interesting, because I think this goes right back to the beginning when we first started talking about force and flow.
Yeah.
And I even found myself, as I got older, the force became greater than the flow. Mm. So the personal growth work that I had to endure after 40 was more forcing myself to flow, right? Because time does dictate how we react to things. Right. And it's the running out of time that makes us force things. So if we're dating in our 20s is not the same as dating in our 50s, because
for sure.
We're dating in our 50s, we're forcing more things to move faster because we don't have as much time in our mind.
In right? our mind. Exactly.
Exactly. Yeah. So it's really interesting when you really see yourself objectively, how you behave in those different age groups, right?
Yeah.
it's really learning how to flow, and you can't flow until you actually admit that you're forcing.
Exactly, right? That's kind of like that paradox. Yeah. what came first? So you've got to be able to witness, self-witness yourself and really look at what's going on and what feels right, what doesn't feel right, where are you forcing, where are you pushing? And then when you see, okay, so that's force. And once you identify it, and it's like, okay, now you can get in that slow boat and you can travel down the flow of the lazy river, go with the flow, better place to be.
You know what? The one thing is, our makeup is protecting ourselves. That's the beautiful thing, is that we have an automatic mechanism to protect ourselves, right? From pain, right? That's ego though, right? So, but what your ego's protecting you from is what you've asked for to grow, right? So I'll give you an example, right? One of my clients, she is newly, well, separated, divorced. She's been separated now for a year, undergoing a divorce, and she's in her late 40s, and she's dying to meet somebody to have a relationship. But she met somebody, right, in the course of the last 2 months, she swears he's the one, and I do believe he's the one. She just doesn't understand what makes him the one, because he's everything in terms of core values, but nothing in terms of delivery, in terms of action, right? So he's like hyper independent. He doesn't beg to see her all the time. He doesn't, he'll text her, and she just wants more of a physical presence in her head. So she wanted to run, because every other one of her friends told her, men don't change, just go. And I'm like, hold on. You don't want to go. So let's not try to pigeonhole this situation into it's black or white. There's nothing black or white. So we sat with it. We stopped and we sat with it. What she wants doesn't make sense. What she wants is to stay. But she's like, everybody's telling me men don't change. So why am I staying? I don't care why, what. All we know is that you don't want to go. So let's sit
Yeah,
there. And
sad.
it's not judging yourself for what you want. So what we realized as we dove a little bit deeper, and this is how funky our mind is, she actually worked, it was the worst week of her entire life, because what she's wanted now, what her heart needs, is somebody who's independent that will allow her the space to find herself again. She was
Bingo.
married for 19 years together with this man for her entire life, right? So her heart and her freedom is what she wants, but she doesn't know what that is. So it feels off. So what is feels off? And this is where you have to recognize what you want without judgment, and then look at what the universe is giving you, because what the universe is giving you is what you want. And,
It delivers exactly with a message, and the energy and the transmissions from our minds go out there and brings to us what we've been wanting and thinking of, but we sometimes don't recognize it. Yeah, because if there's the subtleties, right? There's the, like you say,
We
like
don't know what our lessons are. We don't know what our lessons
the
are. So if you are able to determine what your lesson is that you need to learn, then all the events are not judged anymore.
Yeah, we should just get out of judgment anyway and look at everything as it is what it is, because we brought it forward. So, what is it showing us? When you look in the mirror, what is the mirror showing you? Get real with what's showing up for you. I love that. I love that, because I've had clients too, and one in particular that she wanted her man to like want her more, similar thing. And then when we dug down, I asked her about some past relationships, and she had some needy partners that drove her crazy, right? And I said, yeah, you don't want a needy partner. And so when you start looking at it, just from black and white like that, she was like, oh. I said, well, right, imagine if he was like all over you like a lap puppy, like he'd drive you nutty, you'd want to swat him. Get out of my space. So how nice it is to have your own space so that you can continuously discover like who you are.
And that's what happens when we leave a toxic relationship, right? You can still date, or you can still, you know, do all the stuff to achieve the dream that you want, but just know that the growth has to be there. And the growth is knowing who you are before you jump into another long-term. You can jump into a relationship, but you don't have to jump into a long-term relationship.
Right.
Because that's for the fling. That's the dependency, right?
That's the dependency, yeah. To want somebody in your life, like full time, all the time.
Of course. Yeah. It's a dependency. So it's, yeah. So Cynthia says, listen to her intuition.
Yeah.
You know, it's a classic thing that we all tell ourselves, because everybody knows to listen to our intuition. But after a while, we don't know whether that intuition is our ego or our intuition is really what we want. And believe me, this client of mine has been in personal development for so long. She knows the difference up here, but when you feel it, and it's faith, and that intuition is keeping you in a place you've never been, you don't know what's wrong or right. Right? And this is the interesting thing. Listening to our intuition is actually a skill that needs to be learned.
Yeah, I was just going to say it's a learned thing, because it's not something that we know intuitively. Yeah, I mean, we were supposed to, but we've been so programmed. We've been so brainwashed by the shoulds and the woulds and the, you know, you've got to and you must do's. And, you know, we've been listening to people our whole lives. And most of us, especially when we hit our 50s, we haven't spent any time alone, you know, to live. Or even if we're alone, if we live alone, we're still listening to other people about what to do about not living alone, you know, about going out and finding a partner or going out. Yeah. So sitting just in your own space, totally alone, and trying to get in touch with your heart and your inner voice is not something we are very skilled at.
Oh my goodness. Cynthia, no. And Tracy Williams is here. Tracy, so nice to see you.
Oh, hey.
Gosh, it's been so long. She's happily married. So it's funny. I brought up the relationships because I find that the only way to really get to know yourself is by going out there and making connections with people. Mm. And I don't like to use the word dating anymore, because oh my God, it's just, I like to use the word connecting.
Yeah,
right?
I like that word. That's a great word.
Yeah, rather than dating puts so much pressure on what you're actually doing, right?
Yeah, that's true.
Whereas if you just go out there and start connecting, especially connecting with people of the opposite sex, whether it's having a conversation with a man and without pigeonholing what you're doing, and just start to hear what they're all about. Because one thing my father always told me, there are two things my father told me that kept with me throughout life, is one is, it's not what you know, it's who you know. And the second one is, keep your friends close, keep your enemies closer, right?
Yes. Brilliant, wise words from your dad.
I know, very simple from somebody who didn't graduate high school, but he got it.
Yeah.
Oh, seriously, right? And of course, men are not our enemy, but it feels like it, because they're what, the relationships is what causes us the most pain.
Yeah, it's true. And, you know, and that's a really good point too, because relationships when we're in our younger years, 20s, 30s, and I'll speak from my own personal experience, there's a lot more ego and there's a lot more sensitivity, I'll call it. So I was really sensitive. I was a sensitive kid, and I couldn't take, you know, jokes that were flung at me at my expense. I would take them to heart. I learned the art over years of how to use myself as the butt of a joke without degrading myself. So that, you know, there was a fine art that I learned, but when I was younger, I would take a lot to heart. So I started my relationship with my husband when I was about 20, maybe we met when I was about 24, 23, something like that. So still young, but I'd been out on my own since I was 17. So I felt worldly, and I'd lived in Toronto, moved back, and oh, you know, I'd done it all, right? And so we did get married when I was 27. But through the 20s and the 30s, there's a lot of times, and a lot of kids today you know, youngins, you want to leave, you want a divorce, you want, because you're so different, and those differences, and you don't understand love languages, you don't understand that the other person is showing up differently. All you can see are the differences instead of celebrating what you have in common and what brought you together in the first place. And you know, I mean, and that's so key, is to look at, well, what was the attraction to start with? And often the attraction was the difference. You wanted to, you know, not to use the word complete yourself, because some people use that, but it's not that. It's about pushing yourself and understanding yourself from those different points of view. And that certainly is the case with my husband and I. We are so different, but over the years, you know, I've seen where we're common and where, you know, where we have like so many things in common. And some of them were things that I didn't want to admit myself. You know, so it's really interesting what another, you know, what relationship or connection can bring to, you know, to yourself, to your own self growth.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's key. Harville Hendrix, he has the book and a program called Getting the Love You Want. And
I love their
yeah, you and Kevin went through it, and Dave and I, we did a very small part of it, but it was key to what we needed. And it was really about, you know, appreciating each other. And he talks a lot about, you know, finding those missing pieces of what you're, you know, what you missed as a child, and you'll find them in your partner. But you have to recognize those subtleties, and you have to embrace them instead of just running to divorce court, because it's you're in it for a reason. So find that reason, you know, it takes time to dig it down.
You know, I'm a supporter of divorce if you went into it for the wrong reasons anyway, right? So I'm
Me
not one of
too.
those, half my clients I work with end up divorcing anyway. I'm not
Yeah.
there to keep them together. I'm there to help people find their personal truth. And
Right.
both people's personal truths are agreed upon, and they both consciously walk away like with love. I have nothing wrong with that, because that's
Nothing. I salute that too. Absolutely.
But tying it back like a bow back to the beginning is that, and it's interesting we got into the relationship thing, because I think that's been your greatest work in the last recent like year, where Dave is forcing you to stop.
Yeah.
But he's not doing it consciously. He's not saying stop, but his presence
Yeah.
is teaching you to just fucking stop.
Yeah, exactly. Well, he has said a few times, like, aren't you retired? Because I retired. It's almost 5 years now. I left corporate. But I said, no, I'll never retire. You know, like I'm in the game of life for life, you know. I mean, I'm always going to be doing something. But you're right. So he does bring it up, and subliminally, he's probably sending these messages, just stop.
Well, your body is telling you that
Yeah,
that's
my
what you
body.
actually need. So when you went through this sciatica nerve ending problem, it's basically you having to learn how to stop. But you know, that's the personal growth. Once you hit your 50s, it's finding love and comfort in monotony,
Yeah,
right?
because that's what it is. Yeah. I sit and I think about my grandparents, or you know, we had an elderly couple in the back, and you know, and I've been observing, you know, those that are in their 80s, and it's like, what do you do all day? And it's just, you know, to sit and be comfortable with the monotony. Maybe you read a book for a bit, and then you nap, you know, you doze off, and then maybe you go for a walk a little bit, and you come home, and maybe you fall asleep in the chair. I don't know, but I'm like, I don't know, but
But you know
what
what is funny? Because Cynthia just said, why stop? How about slowing down? But you can't slow down until you know why. You have to stop and think about it. You know,
stop and
it's
think
not
about it.
stopping for life. Whenever we make a decision to stop or slow down, it's just in the moment of what you want. But
Yeah.
next week, if you stop and think about it and allow yourself to breathe through it and understand what's really going on and not be hypocritical to ourselves and judge
Right,
ourselves, right?
right.
Then we can make a decision. Do we want to slow down? Do we want to stop? Do we want to go full force? It doesn't matter what it is,
That's
but
right.
we have to stop the wheel,
Yeah.
because our legs are running with the wheel.
Yeah. Yeah,
Our legs are not
exactly. Yeah.
creating the
Yeah.
turn.
The little
So
hamster in the wheel. It's like, okay, make it stop so that I stop getting dizzy. Yeah.
yeah,
Yeah. It's a
because
key point.
that is the trap. Right?
Yeah,
It's
it is.
action and action and action without meaning or purpose or understanding. So what you have to do is stop, get off the damn wheel so that it's not turning you. Think
Exactly.
about it, talk it through with whatever, if you have a coach, if you have a friend, I don't care what it is, a therapist, then really establish what do you want and then make a decision. But, you know, if you want to slow down, you can slow down, but not everybody wants to slow down. Like at this point, right. You can't say whether you want to slow down, stop, or even go.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So right now I do have to stop and figure it out. And I took a little bit of January and February to do that, which was good. That started to really show me, okay, which direction do I want to take next? I can't believe it's already 8:30. We're out of time. But wow, that went fast. So just a recap, listen to your body, people, because your body always gives you clues. Sometimes big ones, like, you know, if it's gallstones or you might, you know, pulling out your back, sciatica nerve, you know, whatever the case may be, but your body will always give you clues as to what's going on in your software, which is your mind. So stop, take stock as to what are your thoughts? What is it you really want? Getting in touch with your intuition is a beautiful place to go, but that takes practice, that takes skill. So practice that. Start really, you know, listening to, I used to play a game at work, just, this is a small little stupid little thing, but if you're going somewhere with an elevators, you know, a whole bunch of elevators, and it'd be like six on this side and six on that one. I would play a game every single day to instantly, intuitively know which door was going to open. And the more I played it, the more I had like 99% accuracy. Always, it's that one, it's that one, it's that one. So it's a muscle that you're working, you know, same with parking spots. You know, you go to the park and you say, I'm going to find a spot right in front, and boom, you're going to get that spot. You know, so these games you can play, and it's a muscle you're working. So yeah, have fun with your intuition.
Well, it that's really key. The intuition is to be played with and learn through playing. Yeah. Rather than judging ourselves for not getting things right.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's funny because I'm so certain that magic is going to happen, like some woo-woo crazy woman, but it does happen now. I fooled myself, believe me, right? I have, because, you know, but Kevin and I, the government owes us money. So, so both of us, right?
Yay.
Full amount. But check this out. But this is from last year, right? Okay. So, it's been months. So last week I said, what, because I left him to deal with it and they're just not reacting. So I said, okay, I'm gonna just call. So I called. No joke, within 2 days I got my money.
Ah.
Right. And he's been leaving messages and whatever. So this morning I went to him and said, and this is a fun thing. You could all play with this because it's fun, right? And I said, so do you want your money? And he's like, yes, because he's pissed, right? And I'm like, I'll show you how to get the money. But you won't like the way I'm going to show you. Because he is so judgmental on anything, right? And I'm like, and he's come a long way, but it's in his programming to do that. I'm like, I really don't care. I'm just going to call them because I know they're going to give me my damn money.
Yeah. So what did he do? Did he do it?
And then I said, well, I have to go on a call. It's 8 o'clock because it was 8 o'clock, right?
Oh,
like,
okay.
He's like, oh, now you're cruel. You told me that.
You left him hanging. Cruel to be cruel.
Well, you know what? We don't ever change without pain.
Yeah, that's true. So, well, good luck to him in getting his money. I'm glad you got yours. And what's actually on my, I set my intention this morning. So hopefully everybody out there is setting your intention every morning because it's really key. And I am doing my taxes today. I'm putting it all together and getting them off to our accountant. So that's what I'm going to be doing right after this call.
Beautiful.
Yes. Yeah.
I'm just going to keep doing what we're doing.
Awesome.
All right, guys.
Thank you. Have a great day, everybody. Enjoy your week. We're back on Wednesday morning. And enjoy your day. Enjoy the sunshine. Bye, everybody.
Have a great day. Happy Monday.
Happy Monday.